All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the 49th Online Spintronics Seminar. Thank you for joining us. It is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker today. Professor Markus Munzenberg received his PhD degree in 2000 in University of Göttingen, working with Professor Wolfgang Felsch. He then did postdoc in Dr. Modera's group at MIT before joining University of Göttingen as a junior faculty in 2002. In 2008, he's appointed as an extraordinary professor at the University of Göttingen. He moved to the University of Greifswald in 2014, where he's currently the W3 full professor. He's one of the pioneers in the field of ultrafast magnetism and terahertz spintronics. His research interests also include magnetics and spin transport, as well as topological spin textures such as skirmions. Today he will be talking about spin dynamics at a attosecond time scale. So without further ado, Professor Munzenberg, please go ahead with your talk.
Yeah, thank you very much that it happened. The workouts are now the second time. The first I had to be canceled, unfortunately, around Eastern time. So this is now the second try to get to. I'm very happy to show the results that we have here, to give an overview over our research over the last years, because I will start a little bit with an introduction. What we did in the field of ultrafast spintronics, and I try to motivate that first what we want to do with ultrafast spintronics. In the end, we want to do ultrafast spintronic devices, and that our understanding of this research field already makes it possible to have applications of ultrafast magnetism. That means the manipulation of femtosecond laser, with using femtosecond laser pulses to manipulate spintronic devices. So this is a beautiful landscape where we are here. We are in the north of Germany in Greifswald. It's a very old Hanse University, 1456, so quite traditional university here at the Baltic Sea. And we'll talk about a very nice collaboration that we have with Martin Schulze and Sangeeta Sarma from experimental and theoretical side. But there's many more collaborations that will show at least a glimpse of a result in the story until I come to the other second spintronic devices. This is a very fruitful collaboration with Tobias Kampfrat, where we developed over the last years this spintronic terahertz emitter, very interesting application that came out rather by chance than by really looking for applications. Also with Marco Battiato, Peter Oppeny, and Matthias Chloe. Then we have another application with using femtosecond laser pulses that I just show a small glimpse of, that is writing with all optical laser pulses, magnetic recording media. This is a collaboration with Tiffany Santos, with Zen Digital, Jeffrey McCord for the imaging, and also with Cyrus Olinovac and Oksana Chilkalo-Fedenko. And there's some nice result projects going on. So skirmionics is part of the priority program. I will not have the time to show here something, but we have also an archive that came just out today. We have a very nice European collaboration that also just started on neuromorphic computing using light and magnetic devices. So, and then we have a local collaboration where we really try to apply this spintronic terahertz emitters to sense, for example, cells and plastic in cells. This is a little bit old picture of our group. So some of the people that are very important of the group, this is Jakob Alowski here on the left for all the ultrafast dynamics. Rieke Martens, who joined again the group for the terahertz emitters, Christian Decker, he left to industry. That is very important for lithography and spintronics. And Nina Meyer, where it shows some of the topological insulator devices or results. Okay, this is the outline of my talk. The aim is to make, to really show why it could be interesting to talk of attosecond spintronic devices, namely the combination, and this is the real focus of it, the combination using light waves and spintronic devices to build new devices. For that, I'll just tell a little bit of the nature of femtosecond spin dynamics, for the application of the hard disk spintronic emitters. I'll show an example where we can also use light to manipulate spins in non-magnetic samples, namely topological insulators, before I come to the end, the light wave electronics, the coherent attosecond dynamics. So first we have applications here in a non-coherent regime. Non-coherent, I mean that we have spin scattering. So the time scales are longer than the typical spin scattering times in the ferromagnet. When we go to the attosecond, we can go beyond the spin scattering times, and then we are in the coherent regime where we can drive electron waves with light waves coherently. So this is the difference maybe coming in the beginning to make this really our new results. This is the outstanding point of our new results. If you look at computing for your introduction, we are limited already a long time in frequency. So if you would make it possible to have light wave electronics, this would just pimp up the time scales already, because we are limited mostly because of heating at the moment in the frequency, but also the density, the number of transistors limits the heating in the end. So what people are doing are increasing the number of cores, or also the layers, the going to 3D, or making the transistors 3D to make more space. But this all may be limited in and many people are looking for alternate computing concepts. For example, Magnonics is a big community who really wants to look at the potential of spin waves for computing. If you think, many people already at IBM thought, or in other places thought, that it might be very useful just to use the light, where the data comes anyway as light from the glass fiber cables, and you have also already glass fiber interconnects between chips. So why not use the light directly for computing? But the problem is that it's really difficult to get a light switch in the end. And photonics has some problems, but using the light frequencies would speed up very much the computing. The one way to squeeze the light and to make it smaller and to make devices with it is to use a combined electron light particles, the plasmonics, where you can squeeze light and make some kind of transistor. So this is one alternative way to combine light with electrons. Yeah, but this has also some disadvantages, for example, a very strong damping of the plasmons. But there's really nice things and developed already. So there's a combination already of light and electronics. This is the plasmonics. And now the idea is to add to this electronics from the plasmonics part also the spintronics part. So what will happen if you make a ferromagnetic material, if you take our standard classes of tunnel magnetic junctions or GMR devices to couple this to light, to coherent clocking, for example, really to the light wave, the single oscillations of the light wave, this would be on the attosecond time scale, to photonics or to electronics, for example, if you take a very short electron pulse that we can generate with the spintronic terahertz emitters, then this is in the terahertz regime. Terahertz means picosecond long electron pulses, and this means you would have an electronics working with a picosecond clocking. So this together, combining photonics with an ultrafast electronics, together with spintronics, this is the aim that we are looking at in our group for. Maybe since I came from Jagadish Modera, MIT, and this was the general idea or the general vision that I had to combine this electronics with make it ultra fast. Why is it interesting to make spintronics ultra fast? So you can see that if you look at the typical spin dynamics, then you come from the gigahertz. So now 3G, for example, just to give you a direction, is in between 0.7 to 2.6 gigahertz. It's already in the regime where you have the standard coherent magnetization dynamics precession of the Kittel mode, for example. If you go then to spin wave modes, you can go even higher to the terahertz region. And terahertz region will be then 6G. So if we want to go the spintronics to the terahertz to the 6G range and contribute to this field, then it is very suitable in principle, because you have, as I will show you, with the spintronic emitters or the spin rays, you have the possibility to reach these spintronic devices. And you can also use this for computing or pharmaceutics, as I'll show later. I have the next slide. And one other thing is that you can use these oscillations also for computing, neuromorphic computing. This is the FET spin open, but there's many other groups who already did a lot of work, like Julie Grolier in this field. So why terahertz? This is so interesting. Why other areas could benefit from a development of our spintronic emitters from the ultrafast? Solid state physics is many of the excitations, fundamental excitations of electrons are all happening around the Fermi level at low energies, so superconductors, for example. But also in the biosystems, the dynamics of big ensemble of molecules, proteins, they have all their fingerprint in the terahertz region. So it can be very useful if you have a new powerful method. Terahertz methods are generally, there's a terahertz gap. So because of the development of femtosecond lasers, especially glass fiber lasers, there's a lot of applications coming at the moment. We have all the securities at the control at the airports already with terahertz, scanners. But this is only because of the development of ultrafast lasers, and I will show how we can add with our terahertz spintronic emitter. But let's come first to some very fundamental ideas. So what is the ultimate time scale of magnetic switching? And this is the fundamental question that we ask in the end. We have a light wave coming in a few atoms, and this was developed on the theoretical part by functional time resolved density functional theory to get an idea of what happens. So Wolfgang Himmler, Gunping Zhang, Hadi Go, Sanita Sama, Stefan Zanito, these are the people working on this. If you come in with a light wave, then before any scattering happens, because this is a fully coherent electron movement, you have a redistribution of spin densities, because in the presence of spin orbital action, this redistribution of electrons, when the photon comes in, you reshuffle the electrons in the around the atomic core, you already change the magnetization. This means you have a coherent means on the femtosecond time scales already, attosecond to 10 femtoseconds, the typical area where you calculate this, where you can see a manipulation of spins with the light wave. And this is what I want to demonstrate to you at the end, that you really can, in the combination of light wave exciting these electrons around an atom in the presence of spin orbit coupling, can already modify the state of the magnetization around an atom. And by the way, this was the first calculation of the ultrafast demagnetization by Gunping Zhang and Wolfgang Hübner at 2000, who used this method and calculated very fast timescales that were at that time not observed with the experimentalists, because as we now know, there are other processes also going on. But this was already some of the calculations that show a glimpse of the end, the high speed end of the spin manipulation that we could reach. And this spintronic device could look like this. If you come in with a few cycle pulse only, so this are the oscillations of the light at with the center wavelength of 800 nanometers, then the oscillations of the light pulse is 2.7 femtoseconds. This is your clock speed, so to say. And this launches then a coherent electron wave on the same time scale, the femtosecond time scale, that propagates through the ferromagnet. Now you can make it even a little bit more complicated and add another material. And this coherent light wave will then propagate, driven by the photon field or by the electric wave oscillation in the interface, and makes this with the redistribution of magnetism at the femtosecond time scale. So well beyond the things that we observed so far with ultrafast magnetism, that all happens at the 50 femtosecond time scale. Okay, this is the idea, what you look later, but there's maybe some stories to tell in between, and this will be the few examples that I have. This was so far the introduction. Now we go to the experiments. So how does a typical experiment look like that we do? We take a ferromagnet, and then we take a femtosecond laser pulse and try to manipulate this ferromagnet with the femtosecond laser pulse. So this excites something in the ferromagnet and changes the magnetic state, and the magnetic state is then probed with a modulation technique where we can probe via the polarization of the delayed probe pulse. This is then our time scale, the delay time of the femtosecond laser pulse arise, and this probes in the manipulation. But it's not so easy. This is again the experiment. You come with the pump pulse, and then you probe it with the delay, with the probe pulse, and this gives you the temporal evolution now of your magnetic signal. Why is it not so easy? Because as already written in the first paper by Rigaud and Beaurepaire, you excite the electrons with the femtosecond laser pulse. You do a ultra-fast heating of the metal. But these electrons, they are coupled to the lattice. They are coupled to the spins. Every electron carries a spin. So the separation is a kind of artificial, but that's a little bit powerful because you can now introduce some relaxation rates, some typical rates where some processes happen, like spin scattering, or electron lattice interaction, or spin lattice interaction. And then this gives you already a very, very simple model of what can happen. And in this very, very simple model, you see already that it can be very difficult. Now you have different materials, different phonon systems and everything. You have multi-layers, devices, spintronic devices that makes it more complicated, interfaces and so on. And you can imagine that in detail, you have to look at the problem very carefully to interpret your experimental data in the end to model them. For that, I don't want to go into this complication and the moment. I just want to give you two examples that are very important for the applications that I show you in a very, very simple PowerPoint physics way. Imagine you have a localized spins and you come now in with the femtosecond laser pulse. And this femtosecond laser pulse deposits some heat, heats the electrons, we ignore this. But in the end, this flips a spin. We have a spin flip in this Heisenberg chain. So what happens then, because of the strong exchange interactions to your neighbors, we'll have Stoner excitation will decay very fast in a lot of spin waves excitation in the time scale of 10 femtoseconds because the exchange interaction is a very strong energy scale. That means that you have 100 femtosecond picosecond spin wave oscillations immediately that decay in a bath in a continuum of spin waves in the end. So what you do in the end is you heat your spin waves, you heat your ferromagnet by this single spin flip interactions in this localized spin picture. And this has to be quite powerful, and I can show you now an application of this theoretical model for the ultrafast demagnetization. So look at this hard disk here. In this hard disk, you have the read-write head. And in the new era of hard disk drives, you need a laser already to overcome the anisotropy energy. So what you have in this hammer devices is you have a laser that heats your magnetic bits. I will show you later on an image of it. That has a very, very strong anisotropy of a few Tesla, and this heating you decrease now the magnetization to overcome the barrier. And now you need only a very small field in order to set the magnetization direction. And we were thinking that maybe it's possible to use the laser for the heating or femtosecond laser. And since we don't have this magnetic coils, can you do anything different to break the direction or the asymmetry for the remagnetization? And this is the circular polarization. So instead of taking this small bias field of your read-write head and the hammer, you can use the circular polarization of a femtosecond laser pulse now to set the magnetization if you quench it very strongly. And just to show you this hammer, this was shown at the Intermec from Seagate. You really can see it works. And here is the laser coming out of this read-write head. Okay, so we had this samples here. The first work was came out on in Science 2014 by Eschliemann and co-workers. And they used also iron platinum and showed that these grains can be written by the Stefan Major was there also, this big consortium. It was so they showed already that it is possible to write with the polarization, the magnetization, but it was not understood why this would work at all. We already at the same time were trying to understand ultrafast magnetization in this granular media in a collaboration with Tiffany Santos. So we looked also into our samples in order to reproduce this results shown in Science, and it worked immediately. So we show these are here results. You see the demagnetized hard disk media here in the background. Now we come with a circular polarized laser pulse. And you see that we can really write this magnetization with our polarization. And you can also overwrite it a second time. So you can see here this up, down, you can change the contrast twice. And this is the first application of this ultrafast demagnetization process, because with the femtosecond laser pulse, you decrease the magnetization now and you set with the polarization, the initial magnetization, and you really can write now the magnetization into the grains. But when we looked in more in detail, you see that it's not a full writing. This was also mentioned at this in this first paper in Science. And we looked a little bit closer into it, and you see that you this asymmetry that you get for the left and right is well below the full writing. And we looked into it a little bit more in detail. And you see that the number of pulses also determines how strong is the writing. So the contrast increases here with the number of pulses. And this means that this heating and the setting the magnetization with the induced magnetization by the laser field is a wavelength dependent effect, and it gives a small asymmetry. And this process are more difficult to understand because of the heating. It's a stochastic process that doesn't make the full writing. But we have here a full, already an application of that can be improved, for example, going to other wavelengths and so on. The second example where we have a real application for femtosecond spintronics is the spintronic turret emitter that we worked on this Tobias Kampfert. There you see the other phase of ultrafast magnetization dynamics. Before we had the static spins, so the spins, not static, but the Heisenberg spin chain. Now we have delocalized electrons, and we look at the spin diffusion that is driven by lasers. So if you come in with a femtosecond laser pulse, excite electrons, what happens then because of the different bands where the electrons sit in, you have different speeds of majority and minority electrons. That means that you get a magnetic transport on the ultrafast time scale at the 10 femtosecond time scales and nanometer length scales. And this is super diffusive to diffusive transport that then carries some magnetization also around on this time scale of 100 femtoseconds. This was first discovered by Battiato and Peter Oppenheimer, and it's related to the nature of the different bands. So how this can be useful? Imagine you now you have this transport of spins here and this transport of magnetization, and you put here now a metal. Now by the inverse spin Hall effect, the spin current is now bent around and gives now a charge current in this interface. And this means this charge current pulse comes now with a rise time of 10 to 100 femtoseconds. That means you have a picosecond current pulse in this direction. And this emits now turret radiation. It looks like this. You have the rise time here of 30 femtoseconds. This is a very strong rise time. And this emits now turret radiation. It's dependent on the material because the inverse spin Hall effect has different signs for the different materials. Now can optimize the amplitude by increasing using materials that have a very large spin Hall angle. And you see that it has a very, very large bandwidth. It doesn't have any typical absorption features that you have for other materials when you have large crystals, because the photo, it's a very thin film. It doesn't have any phono absorption. And this shows that it's very, might be very useful for spectroscopy. The only difficulty now is that we can mostly use we don't have a spintronic detector with the same bandwidth, but we have already some ideas to work with it. Okay, here's now the comparison to standard turret emitters. So this is a PCS. This is what is in most applications so far. If you buy a Menlo system turret spectrometer, you get this yellow bandwidth from 0.5 to 3 terahertz. And with spintronic emitter, you could really enlarge this bandwidth to 25 terahertz, and the amplitudes of the signal, they are very similar. Okay, this is the second application that we have now with spintronics. But this is, again, a decoherent process. It's super diffusion. This means the electrons, they are scattering. Before I come to the part of the other seconds, I still have one thing to show. These are the topological insulators. I promised the talk that I show something with topological insulators. Here you have the counterpart of the skirmions. In reciprocal space, you have here a spin texture of your direct cone. And you can use this now, even though you have not a ferromagnet, to create a spin polarization. So before we had this ferromagnet, we created this spin with a photon, a spin current driven by the light. And here, because of the spin momentum locking of at the Dirac cone of the topological insulators, we have a plus K direction coupled to spin up and a minus K direction coupled to spin down because of the spin orbit interaction at the edges of the topological insulators. This gives now the possibility to create spin currents, ultrafast spin currents, even without having a ferromagnet. Okay. If you come here with a photon now, you can see that you could, with left and right circular polarization, you could excite spin up or spin down states into the bands. This was shown already by Nugedic at MIT, that you can create spin currents, and this is semantics. It's a little more complicated if you look into the details. I just want to show you that you can see something. This is our devices. We have hall bars that are structured of a topological insulators. Now we make a raster scan, so we can really image step by step the optical excitation. Then we pick up the voltage at the side. So what you do, we do a photo excitation step by step all over this area, and then we pick up the voltage here. And we change for every point now the circular polarization from left to right, so that we get the spin contrast of the different bands, the currents moving from left to right if you go from light to left, the circular polarization. What you get then is this. First, you get a heat map. This is, so to say, the Seebeck effect. You see that the heat map gradient then increases linearly while you move here along this hall bar. And this linear hall bar here creates then driven motion of the electrons. And since you have the spin hall effect in these materials, you can then sense with the circular polarization edge effects. This edge effects point up and down. You have here with the circular left and right polarization, where you excite the electrons, the sensitivity to the spins, and you can probe now the electrons spin up and spin down, driven by the light here in the end. And this is a verification of the spin Nernst effect in, or the manifestation of the spin Nernst effect in topological insulators driven by the light. So here you can see the picture. You have the photo, the electrons probed by the laser light, and now you probe the current of the excited electrons. If you have more majority, you get a higher signal for the same polarization, then you have more minorities. This is why you get this contrast here mapping now the spin density. That means that you can use here spin topological insulators to generate spin polarized currents. And you can even see this in a ferromagnet, where we can control in the ferromagnet now also the polarization at the borders here. By switching the magnetization back and forth, you can switch here the contrast from red to blue. That means that we can create or modify the spin state by the ferromagnet on top of the topological insulators. And we even can show that the circular polarization creates a terahertz signal. So this terahertz, this is a non-magnetic material, and this is circular polarization create now up and down spin currents in this topological insulator depending on the polarization. Okay, I've shown you now three examples. The first, the heating effect of the Hammer media they can write with the polarization. I've shown you the terahertz emission, where you use spin currents to create a terahertz pulse. And here I've shown you now the mixture, let's say, a circular polarization creates a spin current and that generates then a terahertz pulse, even without the ferromagnet. The next thing I will show you in the last 50 minutes is that we can do even faster. So far we have used laser pulses from 30 to 50 femtoseconds. And the nature of the oscillation of the light wave just didn't matter in the end because we didn't have the polarization. Now we want to look at processes that are even a factor thousand faster. For that, you need other theory and other methods, other experimental methods. And this is the last part of my talk, the light wave electronics, or the way towards a light wave electronics. And I will try to make it reasonable that we are moving here to a different regime where we have more control now on the electron waves. Okay, this was the status in 1996. This was very surprising because all people thought 8 picoseconds, this is the limit, this is the internal spin orbit interaction, spin lattice interaction, sorry, energy scale, this limits the ultra fast magnetization. And then Bourrepaire and Bigot came and showed that it can be indeed faster. And the time scale that they observed, this matches very well with the typical time scale that you would just calculate from the exchange energy or for the spin orbit energy. So in principle, this you can think now is a limit. So if you excite the electrons and the mechanism that you have, spin scattering or something, or spin orbit, makes you the reason for the ultrafast magnetization, then in a short energy back of the envelope calculation, you would get these numbers out. So the question is this the limit now? So we put now these complex models now together, where we worked out in our review here for Journal of Applied Physics. And now we want to move at the very first time scales here, where we just have the electron waves exciting the atoms. And this is a time scale that can be beautifully calculated with time dependence to function theory. Okay, in another picture that I want to show you, these experiments are here. So the traditional ultrafast demagnetization experiments are here. You come in with laser pulse, you have this excitation of the electrons, and then by that you have some transfer of energy to the spins, where you have the spin currents carried away. This all happens here. But we want to go now into the coherent interaction regime that was already also proposed by Bigot, that it would be very interesting in the nature of physics already some years ago. There we also showed some hints that there might be interesting coherent features in the ultrafast magnetization dynamics. So here in this attosecond regime, a few cycle light wave comes in. So if you take 30 femtoseconds, let's say you have many cycles. Now we have a very short pulse of 10 femtoseconds or even lower, smaller. And if this wave comes in, you have now a coherent response. And if you have your probe pulse short enough, then you can probe this coherent response. This was already the proposal here by Bigot, and also we did some experiments on topological insulators that showed that you may have some coherent response in the presence of the light. So we teamed up with the best, with some experts in the field, so Martin Schulze at the NPQ, Ferenc Krauss group, who developed over the years this tool already for semiconductors, this attosecond pulses, in order to have this time resolution that you would need to see some response in this time. If you come in with this attosecond pulse, this is in the XUV pulse region, the typical experiment would look like this. Here you have the three attosecond pulse, and then you can, with the grating, you can look at the spectra. Now you put in, this would be the energy spectrum that you get. Now you put in an absorption target, a thin magnetic film. Let's think of a nickel film. And this nickel film has now absorption edges in the soft XUV range. And these absorption edges are the fingerprint of the atoms now in the nickel. What you could do now, you can go in with a second pulse that could be the excitation pulse that has this few cycle characteristics in the infrared. This would mean then 2.7 femtoseconds. This is the oscillation of the light field. And this disturbs now the film. You would get a redistribution of the electrons. This would change the material and the absorption. And this means you see an oscillation at this absorption edge now that follows the light wave directly in a coherent manner. That means you can see directly the interaction of the light wave with the material itself. Okay. In real, it looks like this. So this would be a real spectra now. You see that it's in the 20 to 80 EV range, so soft UV range that then you need for our experiments, because you want to see some circular dichroism. You need some control of the left and right circular polarization of this attosecond XUV pulse. This is just a mirror-based quarter wave plate where we can control the polarization of the light wave. Thus, you get now a circular polarized attosecond pulse of this spectral bandwidth. And you can overlay it now with a few cycle near infrared pulse. And these are the real roundabout the real scales. You can sample now with this soft XUV pulse the interaction at the different points of the light wave with this sample. And we took now a nickel sample and we sandwiched it between platinum as the reference for a multi-layer to see the effect of the platinum in the end. And now for the dichroism, you don't change the circular polarization, you can also change the magnet field direction, and this is shown here. So if you look at the experiment now, this is a movie, you can see here the light pulse, and this is the fields moving now. So the field applied is just rotated here by this permanent magnet. And then we measure the dichroism contrast at this edges of the nickel. So typically in the cyclotron for the XMCD, you go to the L edges. So these are not available here at the soft XUV range. This means you have to address this with the soft XUV range, you have to address now the M3 and M2 edges, but you have nevertheless the magnetic signal here because you have the spin-orbit interaction. But the only difficulty is now that these here overlap. If you have the excitation and you get a spectral response now for the dichroism, if you turn around the magnetization, and the contrast is shown here. So for one magnetization direction, you get this curve. And the contrast A plus is when you change the magnetization. Now we build the difference. This would be the difference in black at time zero. Now, if the light wave comes in, it excites the sample, and that means that you reduce the magnetization. Reduction of the magnetization means now that the dichroism decreases. This is exactly what we see. We can see here at around in between 19 to 18 nanometer. Wavelengths, so at the M edge, you can see that you have here a decrease of, at the overlapping M edges. You can see that you have here a decrease of the signal to that is very strongly, though, so a reduction of 50%. It means a reduction of 50% of your magnetic signal. And now we come with the explanation. So what is happening here? Why do we see a much decay of the magnetization, even though the simple back of the envelope calculation would not say that we get a response from the poor magnet? But we have the platinum at the border. The platinum offers here some empty states. And what happens there is when you excite with the light wave, We have electrons moving now from the nickel to the platinum in a coherent manner. That means we have electronic waves at the interface. And in fact, in the experiment, we see that we have also some ab initio theory that we will compare now with the utter XMCD. You see that the response of the nickel itself is very slow. But if you add this platinum layer at the interface, you see that you have immediate decrease. And we can calculate and compare this now with the calculation. The ab initio theory of a nickel would not show even no response. And here's the contrast even stronger. And the spin orbit calculation for nickel platinum interfaces gives this very fast rise within a few femtoseconds only. That means the platinum interface is very important for mimicking this very fast response that is faster than previously thought this response could be. If you go now to the longer time scales, you get to the incoherent regime. And in the experiment, you see that this nickel film and the nickel platinum layer, they just match the time scales. They're getting very similar. That's what we expect. You see mostly this difference here at this very fast time scale. But you can do even more. Now we want to look at the XUV signal with even higher resolution. So this is the XUV transmission signal. And you can see here now, this is a light wave. You can see with each light wave cycle, you can see here step-like decrease. This means we can see now directly the reshuffling of the electrons in the nickel here with the platinum interface. And now if you look at the magnetic signal, you can see that you have this very fast response, this very strong reduction, so 0.6 is almost half of the demagnetization to half of the value. And you can also maybe get some idea of the step-like response in the nickel as well if you have sandwiched it to the platinum. If you compare this now with the pure nickel film, so the distances here are 2 nanometer and platinum. The pure nickel film, you have the slower response. The XUV has the same time scale, but the magnetic response is much slower as we've seen it in the overview and also in the theoretical calculations. This means this is the first attosecond resolved magnetization that we can sample at the time scales of the photon wave, the response of our spintronic device, because this is the simplest spintronics device that you can think of, a ferromagnet sandwiched to in between a heavy metal. And you can see that similar to the turret emitters, already at this attosecond time scale, you can see as coherence electron waves making the difference if you have an interface or not. And you can think of more complex attosecond spintronic devices in the future. So I'm coming to the end, to my 45 minutes, but I'll show you a little outlook. The question is, can you already also apply some rules at the M edges? If you look at the L edges, you have a very nice separation of the absorption and of the dichroic signals. And this, the some rules are also have some difficulties, but they're well agreed on that you can get some reasonable numbers out of it, and it's used for a long time. You might be here, did a long, I used it a long time. So, what is with the M edges? The problem with the M edges, so you can separate then L and Z, and this would be very interesting. Also, on the ultra fast time scale, it's long disputed what happens there. So, it would be very interesting if you could use this method now to have a very high resolved method to get the L and the S set also out of this overlapping region that you can see here. It's difficult because you need to separate the shapes now to do these integrals to get from the sum rules the S, LZ, and the S set. The S set is more difficult because you have then the differences that you have to integrate over. But nevertheless, we had some ideas to do it with the heavy series support. And the prediction was from the theory, we don't know what happens, but this is the first glimpse of what could happen with a very high resolution. There's indications of an increase of the LZ, but this is something that we will work more on, how to apply the sum rules and to get reasonable values out of it. I think for LZ, it might be possible. For SZ, it might be difficult. So from the last part of the after second spintronics, Florian Siegels, he was a PhD student in Martin Schulz's lab. This is really more like a synchrotron, this setup there. It's an MPQ in Gaussian, so it's a very nice experiment when I've been here and we conducted the experiments. It's very impressive. He's now at Graz and we continue on our work on Skirmion. There, he builds up a photo emission setup there. And the other collaborator was Sangeeta Gata, Sangeeta Sama from Max Born Institute now at that time at the Max Planck Institute in Halle with Hardy Gross. And she did a very nice, gave us very nice insights through her calculations. So I try to show you what we know after this 20 something years of ultra-fast magnetization, and where many people said we don't know anything and what is going on. I wanted to show you that we have first applications here. We have the possibility to write hard disks. We have the possibility to use it to generate new broad bandwidth, very high amplitude terahertz radiation using femtosecond laser pulses. And now we are on the way to even go to maybe interesting light wave computing in spintronic devices, and I'm seeing forward to this experience that cannot be done everywhere in the world, but surely this is a very high, very interesting experience, because we are now moving to a different physics of ultra-fast science in the attosecond region. Okay, this is our group at Greifswald. You see here this nice Hanse town. We have also nice photography, and I could not say anything about skirmions, but I think it was already a lot of things that I presented here, and I'm seeing forward to your questions.
Thank you very much for this very exciting talk. So this talk is open for questions. If you are in Zoom, please use the raise hand function. You can do that by click on the participants panel, and it should be at the bottom of that pop-out menu. If you still have trouble finding that, you can always send me a private message. For folks who is watching this on Twitch, please just type your question in the chat window. So the first question will be asked by Mohammed Hassan. Please go ahead with your question.
Marcus, fantastic. Very nice work. Congratulations. I have an few questions, but I can start with the most important one. So in the attosecond experiment, your pump balls still have the heat effect in your spintronic. However, because you are using here the XUV probing, you able to probe or trace the first few femtoseconds before the heat effect hits. Is it correct?
Yes. You can see it in this figure. So the heat sets in around, if you do it very schematically, it would set in here.
Okay, I got it. You show also some pictures from Kerr microscopy about the heat effect. Do you expect any morphology change of your sample under the electron microscope under the bumping condition?
This is an interesting question, because in any of these ultra-fast experiments, you're going to very, very strong heating. So if you think of the electron heat of for iron platinum, I think if I remember correctly, it's 1,000 degrees or something. Yeah, and this is a very strong heat load that you would have in principle. But the specific heat of the electrons is very small. For that reason, you heat them up much stronger than you heat later the lattice. So the lattice increase is moderate, and let's say 100 degrees. And it's also cooling very fast, because you have the heat diffusion to the bottom within, let's say, 100 picoseconds. And this is a time scale where no annealing happens. For annealing, for example, you have to go to half an hour or before you change your samples. So if we anneal our tunnel junction, for example, you do it for 1 hour. So the atoms don't move so fast. That's my message. But
I see.
But if you take a substrate, for example, that has a very low heat conductivity, like glass is problematic, or have a membrane like silicon nitride, and then heat cannot diffuse, then you have an accumulation of heat, and this very well disturbs your sample. So you have to be careful, yes.
I see. Okay, thank you so much.
But you can see it in your experiment already, because if you have a degradation of your signal, you see it over the time.
I see.
As a first control.
Thank you. Do you have other question here? Let me ask one quick question about the part where you said use an ultrafast laser to drive the terahertz signal from just the topological insulator alone. So that is you use circularly polarized light, which you generate to break
the symmetry. This is an incoherent. This is a incoherent. This already also shows that it's incoherent. Yeah. If I saw Matthias, he was also involved here in this work. Matthias Loy. Hi. So what you do here, you can go with any polarization. So it doesn't matter. That's what you tested. And this shows again that it's an incoherent process. Yeah, you just use the energy you pump in with the light and heat the electrons in different bands, and then they move independent of polarization. There's also polarization effects detected by Alexei Kime. They see an effect of the polarization, but this is a little bit smaller.
Yeah, I see.
A different effect.
Right, so this one has a magnetic material in. I thought later you showed that with a topological insulator, you don't even need a magnetic material.
Yes.
To drive that.
Yeah, in the topological insulator, you just need the spin momentum locking. Maybe this is best explained here. So the spin momentum locking connects now the spin up to the circular polarization right and the spin down to the circular polarization left. And that means if you just excite now with the circular polarization, you have electrons already moving in one direction, yeah? And this means this electrons moving in one direction then use are responsible for the terahertz emitter emittance as the terahertz emitter, as in the other case, even though you don't have a ferromagnet. So this was the signal. Although if you look at the full story, I can recommend you this paper. It's much more difficult because crystal symmetries play a role. There's the photodamper effect of electrons moving from the surface in the volume. So it's not so trivial. So we worked a lot of this on this topological insulators, also with nanowires and on this spinance effects and so. But I can tell you that's not so easy as simple pictures as the Dirac cone and everything is like that.
I see. Thank you. Dr. Matthias Klein, please go ahead with your question.
Hi, Markus. Yeah, very nice talk. I really liked it. I have a question about this oyster. So if I listen to Martin Eschlimann, he explains that this oyster is a resonant effect in the band structure, which means that it's an effect that must depend on the energy of the pump pulse. So how does the demagnetization that you measure with this 300 attosecond time resolution depend on the pump energy?
You mean the center wavelength? We didn't change the center wavelength. So we don't have experiments there. We have only changed the fluence. And this doesn't, the fluence itself doesn't change it. So these are the two experiments that we have here. Are already a different fluence, as you see here, that this is about 0.8, yeah, and here we're going to zero for demagnetization that is much more. This is driving to 0.5, to half of it, and this is about a linear increasing by doubling the fluence. To see this details, we went up the fluence, but it's not so easy to shift the wavelengths.
Okay, so but you would expect that this oyster changes if you change the wavelength because of this. You need to somewhere go in the band structure to get the right transition, or maybe I got this wrong.
It's a little bit different than oyster in our case because you are not in the same material. The oyster happens mainly if you have a two component material like Heusner, for example.
Yeah,
and here you have a really wide, where we have from nickel to platinum. Mm. Electrons that are going onto the different positions, so So the transfer of semantization is in between the layers, so to say. But we can check this band structure if you would expect long, strong effects. And I would say no. If you go with your energy of the laser pulse in this regime here, where you decrease the number of states in the platinum, I would see, then you would see an effect. So the effect should decrease. So this, indeed, this should be experience one could do to really look at the full picture.
And then maybe very banal question on the other slide that you showed, what is the zero time delay? What's the, if you just go back to the slide before that you showed before?
So
this, yeah, one of these. Yeah, what does zero delay mean here?
This is the center of the pulse here. Here you can see really the wave as it is sampled. So this is a sampled few cycle wave with a 2.7 distance. So it's really the measured amplitude that is shown here as a fit. And zero time would be then the zero, the center of this exciting photon wave.
Okay, this is
the probe is then shifted through this exciting laser pulse.
But so
normally you show data where the excitation pulse is very short, and you don't see these oscillations. So this is a typical plots you see, and then it's just clear where the zero is. But here it's in the center of the light wave.
Okay, that's why it's not a problem that the demagnetization happens at negative delays, because there is already intensity. No.
The intensity, the wave comes here. So here you see already the light wave coming in, and here the first thing happens. So it's a very nice scene in the XUV transmission. You can see here this first drop, and here with the second cycle, you can see the second drop.
Yeah.
And it's really going with the light wave.
Okay,
thanks. This is our temporal resolution to probe it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. I have another question. So did you try in the experiment to change the Kelly envelope phase and see an effect of the field on the dynamics itself? Means demonstration, it's really field sensitive dynamics. Yeah.
This would be a very interesting experiment.
So
we focus now on this disentangling of S and L because it's in the community already long disputed. So this is one thing that we moved in first. But the control of the phases would be very interesting. I fully agree. Yeah.
But here your spin electronic dynamics as under the assumption there are an instantaneous response of the spintronic to the external field from when it moves from nickel to platinum, but it could be a hidden delay response of the spintronic dynamics, which it will be extremely difficult to measure. But this is under the assumption it's an instantaneous response. This is correct?
It's under the assumption that the picture that I have from this TRDFT is this this is a picture from Stefano Zambitos. So this is the picture that I have. You come in with a light wave and then you shuffle around the electrons at the atom. And in the presence of spin-orbit interaction, this already does something to the system. And we can see now in our experiments that the platinum is very important. Yeah. So for this reason, we can deduct from our simple experiments that the platinum, the electrons to the platinum are very important. Yeah. But this is the only thing I can say to that.
Okay. But the platinum here is give you the ability to see the spintronic dynamics, which you cannot see when you have nickel only, right?
And nickel only, it seems to be slower. In the last talk I gave at SPICE, there was a question from Hardy Gross. And you can see in the calculations also that, and this is what they calculated before, that the nickel itself in ab initio theory gives only a very small response. It gives a response, but it's not so big as if you would put platinum to it. And this is just the redistribution in the presence of spin-orbit interaction. But assume if you have different materials with a higher spin-orbit interaction or something, that could be stronger. Or the example that Matthias mentioned from Martin Eschlimann, they've seen in multi-component material like Häuslers that you can have from atom to atom, then also a very strong transfer of magnetization. And there's many things you can think of now.
No, it's interesting. Things. It's very, very interesting. Thank you so much.
So you can design your things as you want, if you understand it. But I have to tell you that the experiments so far are more like a synchrotron experiments. So you need they need a long time to get the signals out. So.
Yeah, I know it. Yeah.
All right, is there another question? Sorry, I have to switch to myself when my internet breaks. It doesn't look like there's other questions. Okay, so in that case, I want to thank Dr. Munzenberger again for the great talk.